There were a lot of men's lives wrapped up in this place. Your day would start with walking across this gantry and entering the airlock. At that point, you'd entered another world. A world of noise. There were no such thing as music, no birds singing. It was completely and entirely and brutally industrial in every single aspect. So you'd get all your pit gear on, your helmet, your boots, and then you'd walk across the yard. The bells rang. The steel doors would slam shut, and then you'd descend, and you'd set off slowly, and then it'd just drop like a bullet. And at that point, there was silence. It's just a real shock to come back and see it all like this. At one point, well over 2,000 people work here. Well, when you think that, well over 2,000 breadwinners for families working in the bowels of the earth producing coal. Which apparently at the time was the future, as we thought, but people a bit higher up the pecking order thought otherwise.
As National President of this union, I'll tell you the terms. No pit closures, no...
They are the enemies of democracy. They are trying to kill democracy for their own purposes.
Dangerous, tough job. When you're doing a coal face, they have this thing called the hell hole at one end, and it's got no support. I used to always look at it and think, God, I'll bet the fucker collapses when I'm going through it. And I used to scurry through it like a rat. And I remember I was sitting there one day and I'm eating my sandwiches and drinking me tea, and I can't even see the bloke who's sitting a foot away from me because of the dust. I can just see this dull yellow glow of his lamp. And he's saying, hey, Sunderland were fucking crap on Saturday, weren't they? I said, nah. Anybody came in on the scene, or they were watching the scene, they think, my God, they'd run a mile. And we're sitting as if it's the most natural thing in the world to do.
Being a miner in them times, it was like living politics. It was like not talking about politics. It weren't abstract. It was real. If someone was sent out of the pit for some, you know, ridiculous misdemeanour, everybody in the pit would down tools and go out the pit. The whole idea of solidarity and sticking together, you know, really, really was something tangible. It really meant something to us. It weren't just a slogan. Sticking together just becomes a habit.
I remember when I was buying my first house and I went to see a mortgage advisor. It was the practice then that mortgage lenders would give you 3 times your annual salary. They said they'd give us 4 times.
And when he asked why, he said, your job, unlike others in this period, is secure. You've got a job for life.
If you know what a coal mine looks like, get a job in Britain's modern mining industry and get more out of life. Be a miner. Ask at your local pit or job centre.
A huge crowd and a huge cheer.
Her Majesty the Queen has asked me to form a new administration, and I have accepted.
Thatcher's intention, plainly stated by her, she were going to change industrial relations in this country for good. She were going to change British society, you know, away from dependence on state and all them things. She were going for throat.
Thank you.
There has been a sharp rise in the number of people without work.
Jobs are vanishing faster.
The number of people out of work took a sharp turn for the worse.
I have only one thing to say. You turn if you want to. The ladies, not for turning.
The real problem we face today is we've lived through quite a long period now of increasing trade union power. It's also been a period when we've had increasing left-wing militancy in control of the unions. Oh, yes, we have. Oh, yes, we have, and the country knows it. And the people who are there in the unions, in the rank and file of the unions, know it too.
Unions meant something in Britain. And the head of that union movement was the National Union of Mine Workers. They were the best organised, the most militant. Part of Thatcherism, monetarism, were to undermine organised workers.
The miners had beaten the Tories in 72, and they'd beaten them again in 74, and that really rankled in the Conservative ranks.
There were massive strikes in the 70s.
Tory government were chipping away at his wages.
But miners were constantly fainting back. And with strikes causing power cuts, it was obvious to everybody that we were winning. Prime Minister Ted Heath had no choice but to put the question, the burning question of the day.
I remember Ted Heath coming on the telly, calling a general election because the lights were going out. And I remember him saying, who runs the country? Is it us, or is it the miners?
It is time for you to say to the extremists, the militants, and to the plain and simple misguided, we've had enough. There's a lot to be done. For heaven's sake, let's get on with it.
When Ted Heath went to polls and he says, who governs? We tell him who governed, and it weren't fucking him. To win, it tastes so sweet.
What power!
It shows you working class people, when they're organised, when they show solidarity, they can come together and they can defeat the might of the government and the state that supports them.
Some of the old guys always said, they'll be back for us, the Tories will be back for us. We knew from day one we were firmly in Thatcher's sights. What was stopping privatisation, what was stopping, you know, letting rip with profits, their philosophy of a free market economy, the thing that was stood in the way were us.
Sort of started to organise. Nicholas Ridley, Sir Nicholas Ridley, Tory MP, etc., were sent away to one of these right-wing think tanks to dwell on this. And they thought long and hard, and they come up with this plan. It would have built. It would have Bobby Dazzler.
This plan outlined how they were going to take on the British trade union movement.
Thatcher wanted to smash the trade unions, and she was going to use every tool, every resource at her disposal to do it.
Police were bulked up. They were trained up in riot gear. Ordinary plods who were mooching around the streets were taken away and trained up in crowd control. It was like setting up a paramilitary force.
It was all planned, well thought out. Next, they wanted to stop strikers from getting access to benefits in the hope they could force them back to work.
They were going to attack, take on weaker unions before they come for stronger unions. This were outlined in Ridley plan.
You know, all groups of workers had been attacked.
She'd attacked the health workers, the rail workers, the steel workers. And we realised that we were the next in line.
To break the unions, all the unions, they had to break the strongest union in the country, which was, of course, the National Union of Mine Workers. She knew if she smashed our union, the rest of the unions would crumble.
We knew what were coming. They'd outlined it for us, you know, in big letters, big shiny lights, you know, we're coming for you.
They started giving us more overtime and wanted us to produce more coal. All so they could outlast us if we ever come out on strike again. There were massive stockpiles, never been seen before. We had to climb over it to get in and out of work. The saying, digging his own graves, were never as apt, because that's exactly what we were doing.
The Tories have never forgotten the defeat inflicted in 1972 and in 1974. Equally, neither of the miners.
In 1981, Arthur Scargill was elected president of the National Union of Mine Workers. We knew we were in safe hands for when the Tories came for us. We knew we'd got a leader that weren't going to shirk his responsibilities.
Scargill, as far as media were concerned, as far as Tories were concerned, became a hate figure. He stood as a representative at union who weren't willing to concede, who were prepared to argue his corner and were prepared to do more than that, but act upon his words, and that frightened them.
The Tories wanted the NUM defeated. The best way for them was closing coal mines. they needed an argument for closing coal mines, and the argument was the uneconomic pits. The coal industry was nationalised, and for years we had a plan for coal. The policy at the time was about Britain having a long-term energy supply, rather than relying on what can be bought and sold in the international market and all the insecurities that come with that. But when Thatcher appointed MacGregor as head of the National Coal Board, that was it. It was as if the whole agreement had been completely tossed to one side.
Can you work with Mr. Scargill?
I've no idea. I haven't even tried. The question is, can he work with me?
Fact were that they brought a hitman in, and he'd dumped business in Leylands, he'd dumped business at British Steel, right? And he were brought into NCB to dump business, right, with miners.
It was absolutely nothing about the mining industry. It was absolutely nothing about energy. This man were a union buster, and they gave him the top job.
Suddenly, a pit closure programme was pushed forward, and pits that were full of coal were classed as being uneconomic and marked down for closure. Prior to that, they would say, well, we're going to close this pit, it's run out of coal, we're shutting it down. They'd talk with the union leadership locally, and then they'd say, well, yeah, it is actually running out, it'll have to close. But they didn't do that. When MacGregor came in, he said, I'm shutting that one, that one, that one, that one, that one. Yes, but no arguments, I'm shutting them.
He's getting good money, sound, secure position. And he's telling lads of 20, 25, 35, 45 that there's an out for him. Well, MacGregor's working at 72, I want to be working at 20 bloody 7.
Will you listen to Mrs. Thatcher when she told us we want more production in the mines, we want more production throughout the country, produce more of this, produce more coal. We produce more coal and more coal. And then when there was coal on the ground, she turned around and said, well, some of yous have got to go because there's too much coal in the country.
It was Tory government under Thatcher laying down the gauntlet, telling us that they were coming for us.
The Tories, along with their friends in the media, they had all sorts of figures banded about how much money the coal industry was costing the country, costing the taxpayer. The National Coal Board had an accounting system that Lehman Brothers would have been proud of.
They had said they were going to close 5 collieries. That changed to 20 collieries after a few weeks. But we knew they had plotted to close a lot more than that.
This were about communities and people's futures and people's dignity. These people wanted to trash it.
The Zonit pit's holding this area together. If this pit goes, it'll be like a plague all up valley.
If they close this, they might as well do it now. Put an iron gate up and put a lock on it and say, right, that's your pit finished. You're at school, there's your school, there's the dole office. That's where you go when you finish school, because there'll be nothing left in life.
Pits were closing. You know, Cardowan had been closed, Bedway had been closed, Paul Mays was going to close. Kinnail was closed, which was not far from where we worked. And now, with MacGregor announcing even more pit closures, I mean, how many pits were going to be left?
We could see that, like, 1984, we were going to be forced into strike action. These were provocative actions, couldn't be seen as anything else. Challenges started to become more fast and furious.
They blockaded the office, effectively trapping Mr. MacGregor inside. The miners insisted he should come out to face them all.
And now they came on the attack. The Tories closed Cottonwood Colliery, a productive pit they'd invested in. That was the red line where we had to take action.
The feeling in the Scottish coalfield was electric. There were some incredibly bitter scenes at the NUM headquarters in Edinburgh. Everyone was centred on one question, whether to go on strike. In some of the delegate conferences, you know, it was really nearly coming to violence at times.
It were like we've backed off and backed off, right, till his backs are against wall now. We can't go any further back, so we've got to come out fighting.
The choice is a simple one. You can allow them to butcher the industry, stay down, and do nothing, or you can join with the rest of us and get off your knees and fight. And if we do it together, we can't lose.
Our union meeting, it was absolutely packed. And there was just one thing on the agenda. Are we going to join Cortonwood with strike action to save the pits? I'll tell you now, there was no hesitation. Every single hand in that hall went bolt upright within a split second.
There was talk about whether to have a national ballot, but the strike moved just like wildfire.
Tonight, all the county's pits are shut.
Pit after pit just voted with their feet and they joined the strike.
If Scotland's out, Kent's out, Wales is coming out, North Derbyshire will be out by Wednesday, this strike will be national.
The mines will be out in this country. One out, all out.
And that were it. We started.
Picket line is where a group of workers who are out on strike go and stand in front of the gates and try and persuade the workers going into that workplace to support you in your struggle. Not with violence, with chatter. I'm telling you, support us because this is why we're doing it, and I'm asking you, please don't go to work because your support will help us.
I was so euphoric that finally we had the chance to fight back. And I'd had a few pints of beer, and so therefore we were told we were picketing Monday at his own pit, but I couldn't wait. So I, and along with probably about three or four other miners, went down to the colliery gates, which wasn't sanctioned by the union because, of course, the strike started on Monday. I remember a manager going in, and I remember winding his window down. And I says, this is a picket line. It says, picket line? It doesn't start until Monday. I says, you're not crossing. This is an NUM picket line. I want you to turn round. And of course, he started to put his foot down. So I jumped on his bonnet. The car sped off down the pit lane and I'm on his bonnet, hanging onto his windscreen wipers. And he jerked to a stop. And I remember whipping his windscreen wiper off and trying to throw it through the side window. I felt, really determined. I thought, we're going to have a real good chance of winning.
And we could change the world with a strike.
Me and this other lad agreed to meet at 6 o'clock in the morning at the stockpile at Bolden, which was huge. And lorries were constantly coming in and, taking coal away. And we'd agreed to meet there and we're going to put a picket on, the two of us. So I turned up at 6 o'clock in the morning, but he bloody didn't. It was pouring down the rain and I'm standing in a desolate place, waiting. Then all of a sudden this big convoy of lorries pulled up. I stopped the first lorry and I said, I'm an official picket. And he said, well, you don't look much like an official picket to me. It's just you, is there? I said, but that's all it needs. Yeah, I am an official NUM picket. I've got authority from my colliery to be here, and I'm asking you, in solidarity with the miners, not to cross this picket line. He said, oh. And they all turned their lorries around and went back. But I was elated, to turn back six lorries on my own. And I was full of myself, and I thought, well, God, if I can do it on my own, what can we do if there's loads of us? So optimistic, the last strike took 6 weeks and brought a government down, and so of course in the first days of the strike we pretty much thought we could do that
in 5 weeks.
I think Thatcher thought that the miners would soon go back to work because the women wouldn't stand for the men not bringing home any money, and it would be a difficult time for them. And we think that she was convinced that the women would resolve the strike very quickly. But she called herself an Iron Lady, but she had thousands of Iron Ladies in the coal fields.
The women just wanted to help, you know. I think we knew it was going to be a long time, so there were no sitting back and just letting things, you know, run past you. You had to get out. It's going to all hands to the pump, really.
People talk about the war, the feeling of the country at wartime, and everybody's. That's very much what it was like in a microcosm.
And the first few weeks seemed to be dominated. We were forever at the NUM headquarters in Sheffield. You know, special court hearings and lobbies, and it was an incredible time. And the atmosphere, if you see any of the photos from that time, you see the faces of the people that were involved. It was just, it was awesome. It was absolutely awesome. What a feeling.
And so that general, like, coming together in and amongst all excitement and fact that we were on the move. We'd moved from a defensive position where we were being attacked by coal board to an offensive position, which felt more natural. You were in control of your own lives, in control of your own future.
It was such a daunting task that you had to organise. You know, that was the thing, you had to organise. Organisation was the key to it all, really.
Thatcher, she would not pay money for the young miners, and the families, they got no money at all. So Thatcher were thinking, we'll starve them back to work. But she was presently surprised. We thought, right, we'll approach it from another angle. So we organised soup kitchens, and we had one in nearly every little village.
Well, it started with breakfast, didn't it, first? Yeah. You know, I used to be here at 5 o'clock in the morning doing breakfast.
Yeah.
And she made best cup of coffee in herself.
They used to send some really good things, didn't they? Really, really good things. Mm. We made use of every single thing that came, except them snails. Sent some snails once, and that's about the only thing I think we'd never
and
used.
And spinach.
They didn't like spinach. They didn't like the spinach, the women. Mm. Yeah, that's about the only two things that I think we never used.
It was a bit like hunter-gatherer societies, weren't it? You know, the men went out to do the picketing and all the dangerous stuff, while the women were supposedly doing what women do best, and that is putting a penny on and working in a kitchen. But it didn't stay that way. It didn't stay that way.
It were a big, steep learning curve for a lot of people. And what drove people, you know, was the moment, the fact that it were important that this were like, you know, for a lot of people, world-changing. You know, the perspective started to change. The willingness to do things outside normal routine started to change.
And I'll fight tooth and nail with every one of them, with every miner and miner's wife, to keep the NUM.
It's a bit like being a born-again Christian, isn't it? You have to spread the gospel, and you have to speak to people, and you have to argue with people, and try and convince them of what you're saying is right.
All them thousands of long conversations that must have been going off, because what were true for me were equally as true for all them people that were involved in dispute. All them that were prepared to step up, be counted, and actually get on with job of winning strike.
United will never be defeated!
But from beginning at strike, there were a problem.
We'll never be defeated!
On the Nottinghamshire coalfield, the majority of miners pointedly ignored the instruction to stop work from the national and area NUM leadership.
Each area was given a choice to vote, and the Notts area voted to come to work, so that's why we're here.
Nottinghamshire miners produce 25% of the country's coal, and without their support, victory for the NUM is uncertain.
When we found out that Nottingham had refused to come out, we were furious. I mean, how dare they? You know, this is the National Union of Mine Workers, and if the majority of the National Union of Mine Workers are on strike, they should have came out on strike.
Crossing a picket line was a big thing. It was a massive thing. You know, I'd grown up in an era where you just didn't cross picket lines. If people crossed picket lines, you didn't speak to them. They were pariahs in the community. They were, you know, that word, they were scabs. And so nobody wanted to be labelled a scab. And so it was incredible to us that these people were crossing picket lines.
The conditions in Nottingham in terms of underground are very, very good. They were always paid well, and it was part of Tory's strategy to keep them sweet. And they were told a lie, which they swallowed, which were they were going to be kept safe.
Should the NUM eventually lose this dispute, the cause of its defeat could well be here. Nottinghamshire's pits are more modern, the miners are among the best paid in the industry. There isn't the close-knit solidarity of South Yorkshire.
In Nottingham, their local union leaders were dithering. They didn't even know themselves what they wanted. They started arguing that a strike wasn't valid without a national ballot. They used the ballot as an excuse to keep working.
The call for a ballot was being trumpeted by the media, by Thatcher, by McGregor. There was this idea that only a national ballot counted. This meant one man, one vote across the country, whether your pit was under threat or not. And the NUM, led by Scargill, were, you know, undemocratic, and we were intimidatory. That was the basic premise.
I think it's surprising that somehow they were got out on strike without a ballot.
Why doesn't Mr. Scargill have a ballot? The reason that the miners are staying out is they're forced out by the mob.
The union's democracy and credibility was being destroyed. That a national strike call, which requires a ballot, is being avoided.
What would your views be on the ballot?
Mr. Kinnock, can you just tell me what you
But to call for a ballot meant that you were against the strike, basically.
The momentum was on our side. Over 80% of the miners were already out on strike. We could not risk calling the whole thing off to have a national ballot that might have then cost us our jobs and our communities.
But we knew there was a real debate raging, television, newspapers, and in the coalfields.
We want to go to work and we haven't voted. We have the right to go to work.
It's wrong, morally wrong, when a man at this day and age can support a ballot vote that makes another man lose his job in Yorkshire or wherever he works.
The battle had begun. The time for talking, that were over. We had to get down to Nottingham and convince our fellow miners that the strike was right. Ballot or no ballot. What did we say to him? We said, well, I just said, look, you know, does anybody here work in Eddings? Yeah, well, I work in Eddings. Anybody here got kids? Well, I've got a kid. Does anybody here want Pitt to stay up? Yeah, well, we all do.
They came out with us. We were winning pit after pit after pit. Because we'd moved so fast, rank and file, you know, we'd caught them with the pants down, basically. And we were already into Nottinghamshire.
It was just great to get Pickerton in. It was fantastic to put the arguments to him. And Pickerton was successful until, of course, Thatcher decided to send the police in.
About 3,000 extra police were drafted into Nottinghamshire tonight, doubling the county's normal strength. The reinforcements have come from all over Britain. Flying pickets don't make it to the collieries. Those that do face a new military-style police force, keeping them away from the Nottinghamshire miners.
The whole county of Nottingham was completely sealed off by police. The Nottingham miners who stayed on strike were heroic. I've got full of admiration for them. It must have been bloody awful.
Police were prepared to stop you on the border. When they were prepared to stop you, you know, running, going up to the colliery gates, they were prepared to stop you anywhere to stop you putting the case in Nottinghamshire Miners.
Hi, gentlemen.
All right.
Where are you off to?
Going to Nottingham.
What are you going to Nottingham for?
Well, we're on business.
I see. What do you do?
I'm a coal face worker.
You're a coal face worker, are you?
Yeah.
Would you mind telling us why you've stopped us?
In connection with the industrial dispute concerning the miners.
But is it lawful to actually stop us like this and question us
about
where
yes,
we're going?
Yes, just hold on a second. It's lawful for us to stop any motor vehicle that's on the road.
Is it?
Oh, yes.
You're absolutely sure about that?
Oh, yes, I'm absolutely sure.
OK.
Don't ask me whether I'm sure of the law. That is right.
OK.
OK. I want you to turn round at the roundabout and travel north on the A1. If you fail to do that, the traffic car there will pursue you, you'll be stopped. And you'll be arrested.
For what?
For obstructing the police in the execution of their duty.
I remember getting stopped by the cops at Nottingham when we got in there, and this cop said, what's your name? And I said, Norman Strike. And he said, yes, and I'm Arthur fucking Scargill. What's your name? I said, Norman Strike. He said, I don't believe you. So he had to radio through, and he said, oh, he is called Norman Strike. So I used to have to end up carrying my birth certificate round so that if I got stopped, I could say, look, Norman Strike. And even to this day, people say, but what's your real name?
And who are you, might I ask?
But they never met my mate. My mate was actually called Will Pickett.
So what you're saying is if we carry on to Thoresby Colliery, we will be arrested?
Any colliery.
Any colliery?
Basically, any colliery, you're going to be arrested.
It became clear that we had to try and devise a different strategy.
It was a game of cat and mouse. In order to get to the picket line, to get to the colliery, what you had to do was to avoid the police, and that involved all kinds of crazy schemes and shenanigans.
Well, just to stop just before roadblock, get out and pretend we were joggers and jog past roadblock and kind of pick us up at the other side at roadblock. They used to stop cars with four people in them, so four or five men in them would definitely get stopped. So we'd put two in both, lay one on back seat and one in floor. Well, if you were unlucky enough to get in boot at car, you'd drive round with them and you'd hear them in boot. They'd be going, what's happening now? We'd go, shh, we're coming up to a police roadblock, be quiet. Don't make a noise wherever you do, or you're going to get us all shot. You know, and if it were afternoon, you know, we'd just pull up to a pub, have a pint, have a game of darts, you get in the car and, what's happening now? Ah, you're all right. They're not going to search car. We're on our way now. We'll let you out in a bit.
Can we go on there?
Motorway. No, turn right here.
We've got motioned off the motorway at Junction 28, stopped by the police, and then we were all told to get back, and they led us back onto the motorway. So when we got on the motorway, we thought, well, bugger this. So we all went abreast on the motorway and drove at 10 miles an hour. And then the police came up the hard shoulder, jumped out and started smashing the windscreens of the vans with truncheons and dragging people out and arresting them. They were vicious, absolutely vicious. I was terrified, if I'm honest with you. I never thought I'd say something like this in this country. You know, the police are supposed to be an impartial force.
Now, I know a nice young policeman of disposition sweet, and all the children greet him as he patrols his beat. Impartial on the picket line, to the striker he's a friend. He is stainless, faultless, peerless, conscientious to the end.
Oh dear! Things were starting to hot up. There were a lot of fighting on the picket line with police. There were a lot of lads getting, you know, beatings off police, you know. Temperature was starting to rise rapidly. It was becoming clear that we had a fight on our hands, a real fight. This was not going to be any walkover. But for me, there was a moment early on in the strike when it became much more real in terms of what we were actually involved in.
The atmosphere at Norton was just... It was scary. There were massive police presence. People were hemmed in pavements, and you knew something was really kicking off.
There were lots of scuffles with police. Police were very heavy-handed. By this time, we were demonised. We were from Mars. We were from hell.
It was nasty. The local thugs and all of them, who'd fueled with alcohol, they were given the strike and miners' abuse, and there'd been some bricks being thrown.
Word were coming back that they were smashing all cars up. My mate David Jones, I'd just been chatting to him, and Dave says, I'm off down here, and he went running down because his car were down there.
As bricks and bottles were hurled, David Gareth Jones ran along this pavement towards his car. He was afraid of it being vandalised.
And that's it, last time I saw him. Next thing I heard, he was dead.
For the third night running, Yorkshire's flying picket stood duty outside the Nottinghamshire pit at Ollerton. But it ended in tragedy. Yorkshire miner David Jones, who'd have been 24 today, died. Pickett said he'd been hit in the neck by a brick. In the melee of the picket line, nothing was clear.
This is a strike, for God's sake, you know. Nobody should die. You know, that's not... You don't go on strike to be bloody hit and die. And David Jones died.
Young, great lad. And... Yeah, from that moment on, it was never going to be the same again. This funeral was absolutely massive. You know, people came from all over the country. It was huge. When we talk about unions and we talk about, you know, Scargill, and we talk about strategies for Coal and Thatcher, you know, it's all pretty abstract, but when you turn up to your mate's funeral and there's thousands upon thousands upon thousands of trade unionists there with the banners, dignified, sombre, determined, You know, that's what the union is. That's the union. That's what solidarity is. It's something to behold, really. It's something to behold.
As we reached the summer, it was obvious we were not going to get back into Nottingham. One of the major coal fields was still working, and it was really hurting us. I didn't have no idea how the strike was going to pan out. I didn't have any idea how we were going to win. But as I became more involved, it was clear that we had to do something, and something quick.
There were a report in Financial Times that said if miners actually are able to stop coal getting to steelworks, car production will stop in 3 to 4 weeks. And for us, that were a wake-up call.
What we needed was to hit. We needed to hit industry by stopping steel, and that meant Orgreave in Yorkshire. It supplied the coke that serviced the steelworks. We thought if we could stop steel, it would cut the lifeblood of British industry. It would have a major, major effect.
And we'd love to see every single member of my union who's here, every single member who's on strike, and every trade unionist who's here supporting us, down at the Orgreave!
Every pointer, every arrow were pointing towards Orgreave. It had to happen. It started in May, setting up a total picket. It had to be accelerated. So more and more miners started turning up on picket. Well, then police started to arrive in a big way, and it became more and more difficult to mount that picket. The police were being provocative, the police were mounting charges. So we had to argue with union leaders to send more pickets in order to ensure it were a victory. Eventually they did, and final call came from union, all pickets to Orgreave.
What we've got is an attempt to substitute the rule of the mob for the rule of law. And it must not succeed.
If only for morale, we needed a victory. And Orgreave, we thought, was going to be it. There was thousands upon thousands of us got up there on early hours of a Monday morning. We left South Wales at midnight on the Sunday night to get up there. I didn't think what we was going to walk into what we walked into, mate.
It's a day I'll never forget as long as I live. It was an absolutely magnificent day. We had our T-shirts on. We were stripped to the waist from Scotland. This was really incredible weather for us.
It was strange because usually the police stop you and turn you back. But on this occasion, it was different. They were saying, yes, come in, park in that field. Yes, you need to go up to there.
You know, I knew something was up that day. All I could see in the distance was just line of cops in a field. And in this field, there was policemen with snarling dogs. And they could see all these mounted police behind the lines. They knew we were coming. And they were ready for us. They were waiting for us. They were waiting for us.
When the lorries came an hour later, the miners' ranks had swelled to more than 5,000. As the last lorry went in, the trouble started.
Everything was incredibly good natured, to be honest with you. It was no more than a total push. We were never, ever getting through in a million years. And so there was nothing happening. And then all of a sudden, they decided to clear the field for whatever reason. That's when things changed.
As if it were like a movie happening in front of you, a dreadful movie. And to think you were in the middle of it.
I remember being at the front and
some of the things that I saw, some of the things I witnessed, it was absolutely incredible.
Dogs snarling, dogs barking, and the police, you know, with truncheons out, with staves out, looking for people to eat.
They'd basically been given carte blanche to do anything they wanted to us, and they did.
The older fellas couldn't keep up, and as I was running up, I passed an old bloke, and he was so terrified, he was making involuntary noises from his throat. So I grabbed him, and I just said, calm down, it's all right, just calm. He's just trying to keep him calm now, he's afraid he's going to have a heart attack. And then he was sick. He was physically sick. That's how terrified he was. He was unbelievable. I'll never forgive him for it.
It was madness, complete madness. I could see people lying on the floor with blood pouring out of them. And then the people in the houses started putting bricks on the wall from the garden stones, and were picking them all, loving them at the police, and then somebody said Scargill had been injured.
All I know is that these bastards rushed in and this guy hit me back at head with a bloody shield and knocked me to the ground out.
Somebody set fire to a car, and it was just chaos.
This weren't a game, this were, you know, this was us against the armed state. This is what Margaret Thatcher and the government had put into gear. I thought I'd be running on strike. I never thought that the police would react in that way. You know, we're not robbing anybody. I still couldn't understand it at all.
When you look back at it, you know, figures ranged from something like 5,000 to 7,000 miners. You know, if we'd had 20,000 or 25,000 there, it would have been a completely different outcome. And, of course, we basically, because of the lack of numbers, we walked into a massacre, really.
We didn't have a chance, you know, we were against highly armed and trained policemen. And we were there with our shirts wrapped around our middles.
It was a big turning point, I thought. The level of brutality that was there, the violence that was meted out. I think I realised at that point that, you know, you'll never, ever win the state over to your point of view, that these people are our enemies.
Anybody that was left at the end, you were basically, you know, assaulted, charged, arrested, charged. Fortunately for us, they're pretty poor liars, the police, I have to say. Not one single minor was found guilty of anything.
Get in there and see what they're doing.
And we wanted to go back. You know, we should never have gone away. And we wanted to go back, and our union leaders said, no, that one's lost. No, we're not sending you back. And we really tried to argue and say, you know, we can't let this defeat. We have to go back and try again, but take more people this time and stuff, but they wouldn't have it.
Tonight's 60 Minutes headlines. The worst violence so far on the Orgreave picket lines.
And for days after it, weeks after it, Orgreave and the miners' violence. You know, it was every place. You know, this is the real face of these Luddites.
As industrial relations descend to scenes of riot...
The worst violence of the strike so far.
They were hurling rocks and stones and bottles.
No way is this picket.
They are breaking the law and they must be prevented.
It made an impression on me that over the next 2 weeks after that, that if they could do that and get away with it, and in fact the miners be vilified, which is the cause of the violence, it meant we were really, I think we were in trouble.
We took Orgreave on chin, right? But we weren't down and out. We were prepared to go full 15 rounds. Do you mind taking a clip and going down onto his knees in fourth round, right, and staying down? We got up, we were spurred on to do better, to do more, to win strike. We contact on our own. We really needed support from rest at trade union movement, like we'd never needed it before.
One of the things the Tories were terrified about was, you know, action spreading from the miners to other groups of workers. And throughout that summer, throughout that whole year, they did their best to, you know, offer groups of workers, whether it was health workers or rail workers or electricians, slightly above the expected pay rise. The Liverpool City Council got a slightly better deal than they were expecting. These were all fronts that we'd been hoping, you know, might open up and help us beat Thatcher. There were still many opportunities, massive opportunities, like the dock strikes. And if there was a group of workers that the Tories wanted to beat as much as the miners, it was the dockers. But deals were cobbled up and the chance was lost.
We know for a fact that we were set up to be taken on by the government, and the only reason they're not provoking us at the moment with the attacks on the National Dock Labour Scheme and so on is that they want to deal to the miners first.
Every day, every week that came could have seen end its strike. You know, there were no planning ahead. The miners knew that there weren't only us feeling the pinch. There were 10 million plus strong trade union movement out there. The longer the strike went on, the more chance that another significant group of workers were going to challenge the government for their own ends.
The problem was that we needed money. Claiming social security benefits was very difficult. The laws had been changed, and it had been a long, long time since anybody had been paid. If we were going to remain in strike, winter was coming. We had 150,000 miners and their families in strike, and it was then that, you know, we had to turn to our colleagues in the working class, to all sorts of people. And thankfully, there were minor support groups sprung up the length and breadth of the country. It was inspiring. It was incredibly inspiring.
It's difficult to conceive these days of how enormous the impact of that strike was on British culture. It really divided the country. It really kind of drove a wedge between people. You know, you're either for the miners or against them, and there's no kind of halfway house, really.
There's so many connections at all different levels. So many people have been battered by this government. But when they were taking on the miners, people understood that this was a life or death struggle in terms of actually what happens in this country, who gets what out of society. Is it going to be rich getting rich or the poor getting poorer? Why do students specifically identify with workers fighting back? Well, you know, if you're young, you're meant to be rebellious, aren't you?
There were parallels between what the miners were experiencing and what we were experiencing. We were so used to the media telling lies about lesbians and gay men. We were so used to the police harassing us. We were so used to the courts being used against us. So in a sense, what were the miners were going through, we could identify with completely.
There's always a question, I think, of turning the sympathy and this back kind of passive support into something more, as well as collecting money and food. We also volunteered to stand on the picket lines. But I'm sure when the miners saw us students coming down the road, they probably thought, understandably, well, very nice of you to come and help us, but do we really need your help? Thank you very much. I mean, because look at, you know, hundreds of burly miners in front of you, so possibly not on the picket line. But I think there's also another side, which is actually, gosh, why are these people identifying with us? Let's find out. You built up respect by actually turning up and actually being alongside them.
Other miners and industrial workers who tended to look down on students as lazy, good-for-nothings. But I always thought I admired students. They were something that I weren't. They were intellectual, they were educated in a way that I could never be. I remember going to York University to sway the student union to donating a bus to go picketing in. And I remember going to the university thinking, God, I'm out of my depth here. I'm going to be speaking to these people and, you know, I've come over as a buffoon with my, you know, cloth cap and, you know, my begging bowl, asking for money. But I found out it wasn't like that, that, you know, in a way I was their equal. And it was a big personal moment for me, I think, yeah. That, you know, I could hold my own in debate. And, quite a seminal moment for me. Support
them, miners! When we'd collected about £500, we had to ponder about where on earth to send it. This lad said, well, why not my community? And we just went, yeah, all right, what's it called and where is it? In that part of South Wales, it's pits and sheep. We were quite conspicuous, 27 young lesbians and gays from London. We were all wearing what you might call charity shop chic. Nobody had any money, but we got style, darling. We'd been invited to meet at the local miners' welfare hall. And it's a big welfare hall, is on Cloyd Miners' Welfare. And this was another one of those things for me that will always stick in my mind and be one of the kind of proudest moments in my life, really, was when we walked into the hall, there were already people assembled in there, every generation, grandmas, granddads, kids. And as we walked in, the general volume of people chatting away dropped. And it was a really tense moment for a second or two, because we knew what that was. It's a response to us walking in the room. And then somebody started clapping, and within seconds, the whole room started clapping. Every hair stood up on my body, and that's when I just thought, my God, we are making history. This is amazing. And also for me personally, because I come from that kind of, not South Wales, but I come from that kind of working class background, it really did feel like coming home for me. It just felt like acceptance, that acceptance that's all I ever wanted, yeah.
And it was just fantastic. And again, it just, it strengthened you even more now. I mean, I think at that moment in time, I thought, the only way you're going to stop me supporting the miners is you'd have to fucking kill me, because I'm there now, completely.
It were a beacon. It attracted individuals because they wanted to show solidarity, because they'd experienced either gay oppression or racial oppression or female oppression, etc., could find an expression through working with people in struggle.
Women were pushed to do things that they never thought they would do by just going out and collecting money. It was an opportunity almost to speak at meetings, to go out on the streets, and people wanted to listen. People wanted to listen to you. That had never happened before.
Miners' wives are as determined as any Margaret Thatcher's of this country. She will not pick up.
You think your life is normal, and then suddenly your life is not normal. And you realise that there's a big world out there.
If anybody had told me last year that I would be going around the country, marching, going to conferences, speaking in front of people like this, I would have thought they were stark, raving mad. But this strike in 1984 got more than me motivated. We knew what our men were doing was right, and so the women have risen up into and formed themselves and organised themselves and will never ever be the same again. Not ever when this is won will never be the same again. Because win it, we win.
Prior to the strike, when I would go to the Working Men's Club, I used to be totally ignored. The only words were spoken to me was, "Would you, do you want another drink?" sort of thing. But then during the strike, the guys would be saying, "Where have you been picketing this morning, Cookie? What happened on the picket lines?" So you were being involved. You were being then involved with striking miners, some of whom didn't even go on the picket line. A lot of them were just left at home to run the house while we went off and did our own thing.
It was an adventure. I was going places I never went. I was meeting people I never would have met. Like people from the arts then. They're like far removed from us, aren't they? Or that's what we thought. You know, they offered, come on, we'll put a show on you. Raise funds here, just to raise the profile. And they do boost you. You can't knock them, man.
A journalist got in touch with me from the New Musical Express. He had a band called the Redskins, he told me. Normally said, "We're on the tube. Do you want to come along?" I said, "Yeah." So we composed a speech together about how many miners had been injured during the strike and arrested. But despite that, people were supporting us all over the country. I'm nervous as hell, my legs shaking, and I'm banging the tambourine. And then Chris says,
"And on strike for 35 weeks, a Durham miner."
And I make my speech. Bollocks. We found out that they'd actually switched the microphone off and nothing had gone out live on air. Which really pissed me off. And we go back to the green room. And in the green room, you can, if you want to have a triple Southern Comfort, you can have one. If you want a bottle of whiskey, you can have one. And I've been on strike for 35 weeks, right? So I'm knocking back triple Southern Comforts and, you know, trying to get the lager down at the same time. Then Jules Holland come up and said, "Look, the switchboard's jammed with complaints about why did we censor the miner." If you told us who we were going to be, I said, "Oh, fuck off, you little twat."
Fix it to the miners!
And then I was thrown out.
We can afford to sit down without supporting the miners' cause. Because what you're fighting for, protect jobs. It's not a case of fighting for the wages. It's a fighting for the ability to work, right to work. Well, that's why you find every community all supporting the miners' cause.
Solidarity shown to us by working people of this country, it's absolutely fantastic. You know, not just the scale or the level or the amounts, but the way it was given. Old age pensioners coming up and dropping the pension book in a collection tin and having to run after them and say, no, I've got a mother and all that, I can't afford this.
There was this tramp. There was this tramp, honestly. It was... he came up to us and he opened his purse. He opened his purse. And in his purse, he had 9 pence. 9 pence. He gave us 5 pence. And he said, I'm keeping the 4 pence for, so I can get a cup of coffee. So I went in the bucket. I got an handful of coins out. I says, pal, take this from us, you'll need it more than we do. And I actually gave him an handful of change. You know, bloody hell, I started to fill up. A very emotional time, that, very emotional time. And he says, keep the fight up. Thank you very much, keep the fight up. You know, that's just something that you remember for the rest of your life.
Can we move on to the main issue, really, of this year, which is the miners' dispute? You said a few weeks ago that you thought it would run a little while yet. How long do you think it's going to run now?
I don't know how much longer it will run. I don't feel that it'll be settled immediately. It has been a very long time.
Is the government prepared just to sit out however long this strike is going to take?
I think if any group of people in this country or any government gave in to violence and intimidation of the kind which has disfigured our screens, there'd be no future for democracy or for any other union or any moderate trade unionist in this country.
Is this what you
if
meant?
If we were to give in to that.
Is this what you meant by the phrase, the enemy within?
The violence and intimidation we have seen should never have happened. It is the work of extremists. It is the enemy within.
Forget all that propaganda, all rhetoric that Thatcher came out with. Not only was she wobbling, but the markets were wobbling. The media were turning around and saying, she could lose this one. We knew we'd got to up his game.
The money was great, the food was great, the food parcels were great, very grateful for them all. But what we really wanted, though, was the trade unionists to come out on strike. And in September that year, the TUC, the Trade Union Congress, was meeting where all the trade union leaders were going to get together, and we hoped, we're going to see the sense of what we were doing and how it was going to affect them and open up that elusive second front and finally force Thatcher to back down.
We hadn't stopped Nottingham. To all intents and purposes, we hadn't stopped Orgreave. We knew that we needed solidarity from other workers. Here was a golden opportunity.
Scargill gets up. Standing ovation. No problem. We all support you. Financially.
Despite all the applause, despite all the other support, they didn't call for strike action. I just knew it was the kiss of death. If they were serious, they'd have called strikes in support of the miners. They'd have challenged the anti-trade union laws, but they weren't serious.
TUC leaders supported mine workers' demands, but they wanted to negotiate the way out of it. But they were flying it face at Fikes. Coalboard under tutelage, McGregor, under his authority, didn't want to negotiate, but that were an opportunity missed. Absolutely.
I'd love to see the TUC, you know, get off the fence and do some business. Well, I know I shouldn't be probably saying it, but they should. They should really, really show solidarity, you know, with the miners. Because if they lose, you know, we've all lost. There won't be no going back.
The Trade Union Congress really said to me that we were going to struggle to win this dispute. something would drastically have to go wrong for McGregor. It would have to be an accident at that point.
NACODs, deputies, these are like foremen in a factory, taking care of safety and organising work at the same time. NACODs weren't part of the dispute, but because there were no work at place, by agreement, they got paid for staying at home. NCB sends out a circular. Talk about stupid. NCB sends out a circular, right, instructing them all to start turning up at pits. Because pits open if there's one working miner attends. And you've got to go through picket lines. You've got to attend your place of work. Now, that really threw him in a spin. None at NACODs wanted this. Lots of them lived in pit communities. They lived close enough to see damage that were being done. We actually made it as aim to go out and see individual deputies and said to them, this is your chance. This is your opportunity. These are your communities. These are your people. You have more in common with us than you do with a Tory sat in 10 Downing Street. They had to have a response. And they did.
Number of votes cast for, 11,658. Number of votes against, 2,400.
2,400 what?
Percentage of the vote cast in favour of strike action was 82.5%.
Out on strike by Monday.
Well, then, cat were amongst pigeons. Thatcher and her crew saw what were happening.
There are bound to be recriminations at the coal board that getting tough with the deputies has backfired in a big way. NACODs has now effectively given the NUM enormous support over the pit closures issue.
When NACODs said it's a strike, it were a national strike. So even few pits that were working in Nottingham had a shut. So it had effectively done our job for us. It had a shut pits. So NCB and Ian McGregor dropped a right bollock here. It were an opportunity like no more.
I remember at the time, one of our leaders just going into this meeting and he were just going to pull them out, you know. It were like, this is it. And I remember watching those thinking, oh my God, this is going to happen. It's really, really going to happen. And went into this meeting and he came out. He says,
after careful deliberations, the NEC expressed satisfaction with the result of those negotiations and unanimously agreed to call off the strike, which was just commenced at 6 a.m. on Thursday the 25th of October.
Unconditionally, Mr. McNeffie.
What can I say about him? Hopes lifted. We were picked up like that and we were flattened like that. They negotiated different terms. NACODs accepted it, called their strike off.
They come up with some concoction, some sort of new review procedure for pit closures, as if that were going to alter the government's strategy of closing pits. But it was enough for them to call off the strike. And they kept working and thinking that they were going to be safe.
After failure, another strike to materialise, we truly felt that cold wind of isolation. There were those who were of the opinion that the miners could win it on their own. We were a breed apart, etc. And they kind of continued with illusion. You know, we can go it alone in face of all material facts. We can go it alone and still come out triumphant in end.
Here we go, here we go, here we go!
I think it's fair to say that Thatcher smelt blood after the TUC conference. She was determined to press home her advantage. It was clear that the miners were going to be left isolated. Thatcher could see that. Everybody could see that.
The state stepped in and really tightened the grip. the government tried to do whatever they could to demoralise us. The court seized our union assets. Miners on bail were banned off picket lines up and down the country. You got hundreds arrested and some have been sacked. On top of that, you got the media. On top of that, you got the judges, the courts, the police chiefs, the politicians. For us, at the centre, it sent like we were bang slap in the middle of a war with his own government.
This last 6 months, we haven't been fighting pit closures, what we've come out on strike, or we've been fighting government because they're determined to smash the trade union movement. And once they've smashed NUM, others, they'll throw others like nothing.
I mean, he'd no idea where this was going. I mean, it was only when things, when the picketing started to get quite bad, and you knew that everybody had to do more. This idea blossomed that women could have a picket of their own. You know, we could go. It might be different if women went. Maybe the police wouldn't be quite as vicious and vindictive, but of course it didn't turn out that way.
Glory, glory, all you miners, stand together, not divided. Together we will win, and we'll stop the gregory, and we'll all go marching on.
Disperse, comrades, disperse through the area.
The rest of the women.
You know the forces that be are capable of terrible things. You know the police, the government. You know that these forces have the power, but it's not until you actually are faced with it that it becomes this scary thing. And I think that's what one of the real issues with people were the fact that the other part of the other parts of the country didn't realise that. They didn't realise that they were breaking the law, that the police were actually breaking the laws and the government were breaking the laws.
The enormity of what were going off in terms of, you know, from going to a picket line to see riot police, now they were parked on your street and at the end of your street, now they were following you on from pub on a weekend and things. They're permanently around, and for us it absolutely sent like a siege. Some villages just got locked down completely. They sent in thousands of them. The government were basically throwing everything that they had at us.
Somebody marching.
It was winter. It was cold. People hadn't got much fuel left, if any. People were chopping down trees and scavenging for bits of coal and...
We didn't get anything for a year. I mean, if you want to have some idea of what it was like, well, you know, get your salary every month and put it in a drawer and don't touch it for a year and see how you get on. And, I mean, that's where it was for us. I mean, we had nothing.
My granny tells me that she's seen it all before, and at 94 she's seen a thing or two. She's seen the stockbrokers all crying, and the speculators sighing, and the millionaires relying on a war to pull them through. And they're turning the clock back, I can hear me granny say, yes, they're turning the clock back, and the working man will pay.
I remember one chap in particular came to the strike centre and he was in tears. He didn't have nothing, he didn't have this, he didn't have that, he was struggling with this, he was struggling with that. And that was the case everywhere, man. People were struggling. They haven't got nothing in the cupboard, they haven't got no fire in the grate. They're having these heavy letters and they can't see no way out of it.
It was just amazing to think that men had been out for so long. You know, they had mortgages, car loans, they had kids. You know, they had Christmas to think about. They had all sorts of things, and they gave up everything for that year. You know, they ran their cars into the ground. The effect it must have had on individual houses and individual relationships.
They were basically trying to starve us back to work, and that's why after 9 and 10 months, some men did crack. They couldn't, you know, some people couldn't take it anymore.
There was a lad, I won't say his name, I worked with him down the pit, and he was on the picket lines with me, and he went to Orgreave and everything. His marriage was breaking up, he was in mountains at that. And one day he came into the soup kitchen, had his dinner, then walked out and got on the bus and went back to work. And when he was confronted, he said, I've got a wife and 3 kids. And I said, what do you think I've got at home then? I've got the same. I said, so has everybody else. Has got. We've all got wife and kids. We've all got families to support, but we're not scabbing.
You scabs! You feel ashamed of yourselves, you scabs!
That was all really messy and heartbreaking.
People thought that, or wanted to think, that the strike was crumbling. Well, he's getting, wasn't he? Because things were, seemed to be getting desperate, seemed to be getting out of hand.
People didn't want to give in, did they? People didn't want to give in. They wanted to go, right, how could you give in? Because what was left?
What else is there in this community apart from mining? There's nothing. There is absolutely nothing for the men to do. That's why we're going to fight. That's why we will fight. And at the end of the day, we shall win. I am absolutely convinced of that.
It's worth fighting to try and get jobs for your children. I mean, you see nowadays, anywhere you go, I mean, all these young kids leaving school and there's no jobs. I mean, it's just hopeless for them. I don't want that for mine.
Because that's where they'll end up, won't they? On Dole, let's face it, if they shut the pits down.
Human beings get tired, but organisations don't. They were adding pressure, both financially, psychologically, every way they possibly could.
I got a letter off the pit manager offering me 500 quid if I went back to work on Monday. They'd pay for a holiday. You know, they would do this for you, they would do that for you, they'd pay your debts for you, you know, if you just go back to work.
It was like, somebody dying of thirst, offering them a drink of water, but it was just out in reach, and all you'd got to do was cross a fucking picket line. And it made lots of people angry, but it also made other people think it was last straw. And they gulped the pride back and turn up for the bus to go back to work.
According to the National Coal Board, a further 218 miners returned today.
That brings the week's total to 2,870 and a total of nearly 6,000 since the new year resumption of work.
We used to have on the news every day, the background to the presenter was 31 pits working, 32 pits working. Even if one miner went in with his dog, they would be deemed to be working, even though it was impossible to produce coal.
A massive police escort signalled the arrival of a green coach carrying just one man back to work for the first time at the small, close-knit...
Almost unnoticed, Coughton Wood's lone miner was escorted into the pit unexpectedly at 3 a.m, a deliberate police tactic to guarantee his safety.
National news, one more man gonna work. But that's what they were trying to do, to chip away and chip away and chip away.
That was part of the NCB strategy. They wanted to show that not only was Nottinghamshire not going to come out, that the strike was crumbling in the heartlands like Yorkshire and Wales and Scotland.
You know, we'd be only talking about handfuls of men. You know, a pit employing 1,500, 2,000 men might have three or four people go back to work.
But the NCB are confident that by the end of the week, there'll be men in every pit in the Northumberland-Durham coalfield.
The pickets tried to turn out in force today, but for these men, the strike is over.
I think that the men will start to come back, and they'll come back in big numbers.
We're sending three coaches in with, you know, mirrored glass. You thought to yourself, well, you know, there's 50 in that bus, 50 in that's 150. But there wasn't, you know, there'd be three in that bus, two in the bus behind, and nobody in the bus behind that.
The board says another 128 miners returned to work today for the first time since the strike began.
The coal board's figures show a dramatic rise in the number of NUM members at work.
The NCB points to men returning to work in all 12 areas.
It wouldn't surprise me if tomorrow morning they said, out of 181,000 miners, 203,000 have returned to work.
They were actually claiming so many miners had returned back to a coal mine and it had been closed about 20 years before it.
The coal board can't say at this stage how much more coal, if any, has been produced by this week's 2,200
men. Carrying 200 men entered the colliery.
The pit manager says he's getting more and more calls from miners wanting to return. His relief that production's restarted is evident.
This morning it was announced that another 99 new starters reported for work.
The work at Ellington brought the total in the region to 470. That's 380 more.
Bilston Glen, scene of some of the most violent clashes of the dispute, three quarters of the NUM workforce have collected their tallies.
If this week's rate of return to work continues, strikers here may soon be in a minority.
It's not just numbers that count.
And the volume of it got so loud. This was like somebody screaming in the corner, you know, really angry, why don't you get back to work, etc. You know, everything's against you, you've lost, go back to work.
We can't win, there's no way we can win now, no chance.
The vast majority of the men that are behind that fence want to come back to work.
It's not fair on your families, we're without fuel, money at Christmas times, so you've just got to make up your mind and that's it, you're going back to work.
It was impossible to sustain, even though there was only like 55 working miners at my pit. You could see that the writing was on the wall.
I mean, each time they go in, it's them that's knocking us down. There's no way the board are going to negotiate and meet us on any terms as long as these people are going in. And for them to keep turning around and saying, well, these are the men, these are the people, is utter rubbish, because these people are really slashing everybody's throats. It's as simple as that.
It was like a roller coaster. One minute you were thinking, yes, yes, we're going to win. And then, oh, God, we're going to lose.
Was it possible to win? Absolutely. We could have won. We definitely could have won if we'd have got the support from other unions, led by Norman Willis and Len Murray and other trade union leaders. We could have won in January. We could have won in March. There's absolutely no doubt about that.
You can make these arguments to a thinking head, but I weren't talking to thinking heads. I were talking to empty bellies. Tired men and women who've been beaten.
Another delegates' conference has been called, and it seems that meeting will finally order the remaining strikers back.
The feeling in that conference today is very clear that we go back on Tuesday we go back together. And as far as we're concerned, this union fights to retain picks, jobs and communities. The trade union movement of Britain, with a few notable exceptions, have left this union isolated, to their eternal shame. We face not an employer, but a government, aided and abetted by the judiciary, the police, and you people in the media. At the end of this time, our people are suffering tremendous hardship. It has been the considered view of conference. My very narrow hope that we should return on Tuesday and continue the fight as far as this union is concerned.
I remember it was a Sunday, and I remember being laid in bed, just having a little nap, and I remember my partner coming up to me and she was crying. After.
Sad time, sad time. We thought it, some of us thought it'd go on forever. And I didn't mind. I didn't mind at all. I'm not saying it was fun. I'm not saying it was fun. But I got a really, really lovely feeling of being able to have a bash at the state.
I don't think there is words to put it into. Sorry. I think it was anger. I think it was knowing that she'd won. You know, they'd won, these evil, vicious, pitiless people had won. And looking into the future was a bit bleak.
Remember the day the lads went back, and they had the lodge banner and the band and everything, and they all marched in, and I stood and watched them. And then they all marched in and went to get changed in the changing rooms, and I went to the office and handed me notice in. My marriage was over. My marriage broke up in the November. Which was a shock. You know, I was happily married with two kids when the strike started, and unhappily married. I had to move out the family home so she could get social security, because she wouldn't be the wife of a striking miner anymore. She'd be like a single mum. I didn't want my marriage to end, obviously. I didn't want to have to leave my kids. I didn't want to be defeated. And I was. But if I had my time over again, I'd do the same thing. It's too important. It's more important than my marriage. It's more important than my life. Yeah, it was the future of the trade union movement in this country, as far as I could see. We were right. We're lost, but we were right.
Grim-faced British coal executives preparing to deliver the worst possible message on the future of the industry, while they spoke of massive job losses and pit closures on an unprecedented scale, thousands of miners throughout Britain waited to hear their fate. 30,000 jobs are to be lost in the next 5 months, and 31 pits will cease production. Five pits exist tonight in the northeast, four to go, leaving just one. The number of pits in Yorkshire will be almost halved by the closure of 11 collieries. The same applies to the Nottingham Group, 13 now, but seven are to go. There are eight pits in the Midlands and the North West, six of them will be axed. Wales has four, and three are going,
leaving just one. And in Scotland, its single mine remains open.
It's waste. Talent, resources, everything.
What will you do?
Struggle, same as everybody else.
Well, it's devastating, isn't it? You know what it is. Not long to do, eh? 27-year pit, not double, eh?
Like most Nottinghamshire miners, John Brown worked through the 84 strike. Today, he said, Scargill was right.
Seen the whole lot of this coming. Our union, they must wear blindfolds. They've never told us that this is going to happen. Arthur predicted this years ago. We should have listened to Arthur.
We got beat, you know, we got beat. And we paid a heavy price for it. You know, within 10 years, they shut nearly every single pit down that Britain had that worth talking about. The mining industry wiped out. That's how far they were prepared to go. That was their end game. They were prepared to lose an industry to defeat that beacon of hope, that NUM, that organised group of workers, what were a beacon to millions of workers all over the world.
It's 30 years since the strike. I am so angry. I'm probably angrier now than I was at the time. We live in a country that produced nothing, absolutely nothing. What it's meant for generations of working people in these villages. It wasn't just us that was beat then, you know, their families have been destroyed because of it. The number of guys that I've known that committed suicide in the wake of the miners' strike, I'm so angry. And it could have been different.
You know, there was a man at the pit that I worked at who, when they shut the pit, went to his house with a gallon of petrol, sat in the bath, poured the petrol over himself and set fire to it. Because they shut his pit down and he couldn't face it.
It was more than a defeat for miners. It was a defeat for trade unionism in Britain.
The argument ran, you know, if miners lost, then what chance have we? And that rippled out into throughout working class and all its institutions.
We were the enemy of the state and of the political elites in this country because we recognised that they wanted to tame the trade unions so that they wouldn't interfere with the business of profit-making, and that's what it was all about. It was about defeating the miners so that they would be able to boost their profits later on when the miners were defeated. And as we can see, I think we're all suffering from the legacy of that defeat. You know, with record levels of unemployment, you know, wages being driven down, conditions, you know, roughshod over. It's, you know, they're the scars of defeat.
And it wasn't just coal mines that were closed down, you know, all sorts of factories and mills and breweries, everything was closed down. 20 years, 30 years later, it's all the talks about how much social security is costing the nation. And there's all these people, lo and behold, surprise, surprise, you know, have they worked for two generations? And you think, whose fault's that then?
All the things that have happened since can all be traced back to 1984-85, the great strike that we lost. And we should never have lost it. One union, rail workers, dockers, just one union had joined us, we would have won that strike. But we didn't. And our defeat changed everything for the next three decades.
Watching time just roll.
that in the British economy, there will be no no-go areas for free enterprise.
One question about privatisation is quite how prices will be regulated.
The shares in privatised industries have pushed the stock exchange system almost to breaking point.
Does enterprise and liberty rise from the dead ashes of state control?
The list of government assets sold off reads like a roll call from Britain's industrial heritage.
We've laid the economic foundations of a decent and prosperous future.
Knowledge of the past that we can seek to do something about future. Our strike shone as a beacon that even though states against you, you can fight back. And that side of it has lingered on. They've not defeated us. We've lost the battle, we've not lost the whole war.
Certainly not beautiful. It's just scrubland, really, isn't it? The machinery and things like that, I don't feel sad about losing machinery and conveyor belts and things, but it's what them that machinery meant to people and what it enabled us to do. That's what runs through the veins of these communities, and I feel it's lost. That's what happens when you have a fight and you lose. You know, if we'd have won, it would have been different. You know, I don't want to get romantic about it, but I know that if we'd have won, it would have been a better world for everybody. It definitely would have been a better world for everybody. Who knows? Come back in 100 years and things might be different. The future's still up for grabs.
Tell me, have you got a new shirt? Is its colour a fine bright blue? Has your mother sent you off to your school from the street with a pretty view? Shall we wrestle in the old schoolyard like the other children do? You can scuff your shoes, you can tear your hands, and they'll rip that shirt off you.
Tommy, since you moved away, they've taken our town and they made it new. Now there stands a chemical plant where the cherry orchards grew. And I married Lucy from the back of our class, who once wrote letters to you. We've got kids and we sent them to school from the street with a pretty view. Oh, yeah, Shadamaloo. Mary, Tommy, we grew up too quick from the field. Where the flowers grow, from a butterfly stick to a barren and a brick, changing uniforms far too soon. Hey now, Tommy, shall we meet again in the morning wet with you? Me at the gates of the colliery, you in your shirt of blue. Shall we wrestle in the muddy patch like the other poor men do? We can scuff our boots, we can tear our hands and our ribs.